sermon in the morning. We want to express our appreciation to John West and his sons, this fellow called Philip Schrey, and Gary Blassingame, and whoever else was involved. Jeff wasn't in, Jed rather, wasn't involved in what I'm about to say, but he was out here digging in the water. We appreciate all these men doing what they're doing. Now, what the other fellows were doing is trying to set up a camera system so that we can kind of know what's going on. And we kind of elaborate. We appreciate that. So hopefully it'll be finished before too long. We appreciate all the efforts of people who take their time, and they could be spending it somewhere else and do this kind of work for the good of all of us in the days in which we live. And facing the facts of those days, the reality of them, then some things must be done to help with our own safety. So we appreciate their efforts. First day of a new year, first Lord's Day of a new year, and the first day of the rest of your life. What to preach on? Well, I've chosen one that's not new. I haven't preached this sermon here in quite some time, though the passage is one we use most often. It's full of great things. We would think seriously about what they mean to your life. And it's in the Sermon on the Mount where the Lord is talking to his followers, his disciples, about how to live in this life and how that being learners and followers of him means that you live a different kind of life from the people who are anchored to this world. The people who walk on the level of the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life. And he would say, since his audience was Jewish, he's still in his earthly ministry, he is in his fleshly body a Jew. Concerning the Gentiles, he said, all these things of this life do the Gentiles seek. But of course, he's talking about then, that's not what followers, my followers do. Well, I want you to think about this too. What could I say today, for that matter, anytime? What could anyone say to you from God's good word? And there are a number of things that would be great to say and understand and live by. But being that this is the first day of a new year, the first Lord's Day, always, whatever day you're living is the first day of the rest of your life. What could I say? What could I say that will help you to be more faithful? To take God at his word and act accordingly. What could I say that would remind us we're just pilgrims traveling through and that everything we behold and experience with our five senses will someday no longer exist when the world destroys this, when the Lord destroys this world? What could I say that would make us better as in applying the truth of God to assembling with the saints to worship God? What could I say that would make you a better man or woman, father or mother, husband, wife? What could I say that would simply make you a better Christian, one who is of Christ, that you would grow in faith and knowledge and grace of the Lord Jesus Christ? That would make you stronger, that would ultimately cause you to escape hell, where most people who are responsible to God will go, that have ever lived on this earth, and keep you faithful, that you will obtain heaven. Or for someone here that's not a child of God, to motivate you to learn to choose spiritual things by beginning in obedience to the gospel to become a Christian. What could I say? So I simply chose what Jesus said as he came to the close of Matthew 33 in light of what all he said before verse 33. He said, but, to begin that verse. And that meant contrary to the things I've just been saying that apply to the people of this world who think only according to this world. Whose aspirations and joys are found in this world. He said, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." Now, to understand fully what it meant about all these things, just read before what the Gentiles seek after. We sometimes sing a song that says, "God will take care of you." Maybe we ought to sing it in private. "God will take care of me." I don't understand how all my life, I've never understood how he does the things that he does. I've never really, if my memory serves me correctly at all, given a lot of thought to how he's going to work these things out. I just knew from his word that he would take care of me if I followed what is laid out in verse 33. That has to do with me as a man, as a husband, as a father, as a citizen of this country, or whatever else. If I will follow what is set out by our Lord who loves us and gave himself for us, if I will follow what is taught, Matthew 6:33, you can't help but be a stronger child of the living God. I didn't say you would ever reach a stage in this life that you would not have need of growth. If I thought that no one could grow, I wouldn't be preaching to you this morning. But you cannot tell me that if people abide by from the heart what he teaches here, that you'll be a much stronger Christian. You will view the world in a completely different way. You'll view your wife or husband or children or extended family in a different way. You'll certainly view your involvement in the job you have in a different way. You will have embraced the teaching of Christ, who never taught a thing that wasn't for our good. So again, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." There are four natural divisions in that verse. He tells us of an obligation to seek. He then has to do with the order in which we are to seek, and that's first. He then tells us what to seek: the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And then he pronounces a conditional blessing. All these things shall be added unto you. Now let me say this in the very beginning, as I've said it so many times before throughout wherever I've preached much and preached this sermon. Your problem, or anybody's problem with this verse, is not in the normal person's inability to understand the message. I think the English is on about a fifth grade level. Even though I realize in this day and age that may be too much for some when it comes to reading and understanding. But I don't think in this audience that's the case. In fact, I know your problem, if you have one with this verse, will not be because you just can't understand the message. But like so many verses in the Bible that are essential to going to heaven, when something goes against our likes and dislikes, our will, what we really love, then we just don't see what's there because we do not want to see it. Now, if you become a Christian, you had to see it to some extent to be able to receive with meekness. There's the right attitude. With meekness, the engrafted or implanted word which is able to save your soul. So there had to be in a person who really and genuinely became a Christian and being baptized into Christ and following each step in the New Testament plan of salvation, there had to be desire based upon the principles of Matthew 6:33. But once you become a Christian, that's the beginning, not the end. And too often people just rely on the fact they've been baptized for the remission of sins, is that simply takes the place of everything God requires of a person to be a faithful member of the church of our Lord. And it's not. As we mentioned in class this morning, you see those Israelites who were baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and by that, at God's direction, they escaped the bondage, the slavery of Egypt. But what happened to all of those besides Joshua and Caleb, who were 20 years old and upward, as far as entering finally the land of Canaan? They all died in the wilderness. Thousands upon thousands upon thousands of them, 20 years old and upward, save Joshua and Caleb, died in the wilderness. Now why? Hadn't they been baptized with Moses in the cloud of the sea? Hadn't they been made free from the bondage in Egypt, which is a type of our bondage to the devil? And the baptism unto Moses in the cloud of the sea, a type of the baptism that puts us into Christ and remits our sins, Acts 2:38, Galatians 3, verse 27. Yes, they are, but it was only the beginning. Now, the trip turned into a 40-year trip because of their unwillingness to obey God, though they were freed from bondage in Egypt, to go up and possess the land not that long after they left Egypt. Wouldn't do it. They just would not do what God said. Yet all those years from Abraham down to that present time, they had yearned for the land flowing with milk and honey. And so their faith just wasn't much. If they couldn't get it done by the way they saw things, by their own human power, can't be done. Giants in the land, they said. 10 of them, the spies sent out. And we were as grasshoppers in their sight. That's not a statement coming from people who take God at His word and trust Him accordingly. So the word seek in the first movement of this verse is so significant. Defined, it means a diligent search, a patient inquiry to learn my obligation to God and to fulfill it. It's not just I read the Bible and that's interesting. You're searching the Scriptures to learn what must I do to be faithful to God. The idea of studying, which means being studious, studying to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be shamed, rightly divided, handling it right, handling it correctly, the word of truth, is because that's what it takes to learn what God's will is for David Brown. And that's true if you put your name there, of every member of the Church of our Lord. Remember, most of that New Testament is written to members of the church, Christians. Now, why would that be the case? Because there's a lifelong journey, whether 5 years or 50 years, that people must travel in demonstrating their love of God and faith in God. Now, the first question you need to ask on this first day of a new year and first Lord's Day, having to do with what will help me be sure I am faithful, that heaven will be my home, is, am I seeking? Am I putting all that I am and have of our mental abilities into learning God's will for me that I can discharge that duty? That's what the Lord teaches. He says the person who does this is in contrast to the people who just walk according to what they can feel and see with their physical 5 senses. Jesus demonstrated this for us when He said in John chapter 9 and verse 4, I must work the works of Him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man shall work. What did Jesus tell us about what was on His mind to get done what He came to earth to do? It's imperative. I must. I am obligated. Well, He was the only one that could do it, couldn't He? Nobody else could. He couldn't say, let George do it. He had to do it. And He had a stipulated period of time to get done what was His responsibility to do. Now, He's the example for us as the head of the church, His spiritual body, and each one of us members in particular. So there must be this great desire to seek diligently, give ourselves to learning the will of God. What does that say about Bible study every day in our lives? What does that say about my closeness to God? Well, you will not be any closer to God than your knowledge of the Bible allows you to be. You just can't be. God said, draw nigh to him, and he would draw near to us. Well, how can you be drawing nigh to him when we won't take the time to listen to what he says and study the Bible to learn my duty to God? And is there ever a time that we don't need to do that, regardless of how much Bible we know? It is an ongoing thing. It's the way it works. God has ordained that Christ will be formed in us if we do this. Don't do it, and he won't be. It will strengthen our expectation of heaven, desire to go there. It'll remove the roots that hold us to this present world. It'll remind us that we are pilgrims just traveling through, and we're always just one heartbeat from eternity. Always. And we never know when it's going to come to an end. But it will. It will come to an end. Well, we leave seek, that very important little word, and never run over little words in the Bible, for many times they hold so much information that we need to be faithful to God. And we go then to the word first. There's the order in which we are to do the seeking, to diligently and patiently search the Scriptures to learn our will that we may do the Lord's will. You know, it's just not hard to understand number one. Again, it comes back to what I said earlier. Our problem with this verse is not our inability to understand the message. Here's what the problem is. It's our inability to apply it like the Lord said. We find ourselves many times anchored more to this world than what we think we are till we do the proper examination. We think of ourselves sometimes as far stronger faithfully than we are, when really we are making judgments as to what we do and don't do as humans strictly see things without the aid of the revelation of God's mind. A lot of decisions are made in the Lord's church by members and even elders on the basis of what looks like ought to be or ought not be as humans view things. You can't do that and be what God wants us to be. How do I understand first? Well, if I have two places to go, one for the Lord and one to suit myself, and they both can't be done at the exact same time, which do I choose? It's that simple to understand the message that our Lord gives us here. All too often, we choose what we want to do. Or we revert back to what we like best or the way we think it ought to be as humankind operates. Rather than to say, well, the Lord said we could do it. Yeah, but I don't understand how. Did he say we could do it? Well, yes, he said, but I don't understand how. If he said we could do it, if it's our duty to do it, and we know the Bible teaches it, then if I act by faith, how am I going to act? Well, remember, there were 12 spies sent out into Israel, we've already referred to. They had enough faith to follow Moses, to go through the baptism unto Moses. But now that there is the land right before them that for hundreds of years they had longed for, they searched it out, and from their mere human view of things, we can't do this by ourselves. And God never asked you to do it by yourself. There's nothing that God has enjoined upon us to do that's obligatory, that's necessary to go to heaven, that he said, you're all alone. Even Jesus called the apostles who experienced such terrible, terrible persecution for the cause of Christ. I will be with thee always, even unto the end of the age. But I don't understand how. Folks, don't you know when you say that, you're demonstrating little faith in what God said? When you know what your duty is, it's simply a matter of doing what he said and the way he said it and for the reason. In some cases, there's more than one reason to do it. First means number one. And if I can't do what I want to do because I'd have to leave God's work undone to do what I want to do, then I don't do what I want to do. It's that simple. If it's going to handicap the work of the church, if I do what I want to do first, then I don't do it. That would be true of a man making decisions for himself and as a husband and as a father. Always making those decisions in the light of God's word and through the woman, wife, and mother. And rearing children in that atmosphere, that environment. Well, we're taught what to put first, the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Now, to seek first the kingdom of God, kingdom means it's a monarchy. It's God's monarchy. The word of the king is law. Jesus is the king. He's the head of the church. The church belongs to him. If you're a member of it, you belong to him, first, foremost, and always. His will is to be done. Even he set the example, not as a human wanting to suffer on the cross, but saying to get done what God wants me to do, not my will, but thine be done. That ought to characterize every member of the church. Well, what is it to seek the kingdom of God? Well, if you're outside of Christ, it means to meet the terms of entrance into the kingdom, because the blessings God has for people spiritually are in the kingdom. The kingdom is the church. Read Matthew 16, you'll see it. If you read Colossians 1, you'll find that Paul addresses those brethren in Colossae as those who were translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Which also proves the kingdom is not way out there ahead of us, but the kingdom has been in existence for 2,000 years. John says in Revelation 1 that he is in the kingdom with those that he's writing to. Now, how does a person get into the kingdom? Well, if you look at John 3, verses 3 and 5, Jesus said you must be born again to get into the kingdom. And he didn't mean a physical birth. For he rebuked Nicodemus for thinking that's what it was. He said you must be born of water and the Spirit. But also Jesus said in the Great Commission, Mark records, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Things equal to the same thing, folks, are equal to one another. Let me say that again. Things equal to the same thing are equal to each other. Thus, if I must be born water and spirit to enter the kingdom, Jesus says that one must believe and be baptized to be saved, then it becomes obvious that the Holy Spirit in the New Testament of Christ has said that one must believe in Christ, repent of his sin, confess his faith in Christ as the Son of God, and be baptized into Christ for the remission of sins. So to be born of water and the Spirit is to do what the Spirit said regarding being baptized. And now you're back to the Ethiopian eunuch who had preached unto him Jesus, because Philip sought to save his soul by the gospel. And the next thing you find is that the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What doth hinder me from being baptized?" Philip said, "If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest." He stopped that chariot, went down to the water, Philip baptized him. Eunuch came up out of the water and he went on his way rejoicing. Well, he should. Every sin he had was remitted. So to be born of water and the Spirit is simply to believe and be baptized for the remission of sins. The Word of God is the sword or instrument the Spirit uses to convict us of sin, to convert us to Christ, and to keep us faithful in the church. So it is to be born of water and the Spirit is simply to obey Christ, obey the gospel, comply with the steps of the terms of the plan of salvation, and be baptized into Christ, into the kingdom, where God has located all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. So Paul wrote in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3. But it also says, and his righteousness. Well, many times I, from this pulpit and other places, have shown the biblical definition of righteousness by the inspired pen of David in Psalm 119, verse 172, where David said, "My tongue shall speak thy word, for all thy commandments are righteousness." Now, how can you be righteous and not keep his commandments? When all of God's commandments are righteousness, commandments are given of God to us, it's obligatory upon us. That's what a commandment does. It's make obligatory upon us whatever it commands us to do. And we're commanded to be baptized to be saved. And then in the church, where all spiritual blessings in heavenly places are located, then we must continue to be faithful in all those things God enjoins upon us that Christians are to do, or else we, like fleshly Israel of old, will lose our souls in our wilderness wandering. For our faith will be put to a test. Your individual belief in God, once you become a Christian, will be tried to see whether you will stick with it, or you will let somebody or something or some trouble become more important to you than the church of the living God and living faithful in it. So there is seeking first the kingdom of God, but also seeking first His righteousness, seeking first His commandments. Do we look into the Bible, as I said earlier, to find a commandment we may have missed? A lot of people make light of commandment keeping. The first one that ever did was the devil, and his children always do so. But Jesus is the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey Him, Hebrews 5 and verse 9. So why would I dare make light of a thing like that? Because nobody's going to heaven if you don't obey the Lord. But then we come to the end of the passage on this first day of a new year, on this first Lord's Day of a new year, on this first day of the rest of your life, however long that'll be for us. And all these things you've added unto you. Well, He's not going to do like the health and wealth false teachers teach, that if you obey the Lord and become a Christian, I'll give you several $1 million and 1,000 acres of land and all that stuff. What He's saying is, I put you in this world, made you fleshly, and know what you need. You put Me first in every thought, word, and action, I'll take care of it. I don't understand how I can do it. Well, He didn't want you to worry about that. You see, we worry because we take thought about things we can do absolutely nothing about, and that is not what we ought to do. We ought to be concerned about learning this book, and from the heart obeying everything God said do. And that's all. Remember, fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the W-H-O-L-E, whole duty of man. Nothing else ought to concern us. It'll all fall into place if we'll try to do that. The better our lives will get, better and better, as God intends life on this earth, the flesh to be for the child of God, if we'll let that develop to trying to figure out God's business. All these things will be added to you. Now, I say again in closing the lesson, this, by the way, is a foundation for what I'm going to say this afternoon, so be sure and be here. It's a foundation for anything you want to be when it comes to serving God. It's the only foundation. It's a state of mind. It's an attitude. It must be cultivated. Because how am I going to examine myself to see whether I be in the faith if I don't follow the teaching of Jesus and what He said ought to come first in my life and your life? So He'll give us what we need in this earth. He knows we're here just for a short period of time. While the longest lives we can live is still a short period of time, He'll take care of us. So when you sing the song again, God will take care of you, be sure you really mean it this time. Because you say in your mind, I will follow. Matthew 6:33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. If you're not a child of God, we studied how to become one, and we pray you will obey the gospel. As a child of God, have you been living as you know you ought to, or the affairs of this world, frankly, have come first in your life? You can repent of those things, truly repent and turn from them. Pray God for forgiveness, having confessed them, and God will forgive. This is a great opportunity on this first day of the week and first Lord's Day, if your life hasn't been what you know it ought to be, to make those necessary changes. And do so now while we sing this song of invitation.